The early history of the solar system is surprising in how radically different it used to be compared to now. Early in the sun's history, it was not the lone wanderer that it is today, but rather probably part of what's known as an open star cluster, where a star-forming region has spawned a group of related stars, and as they all began the process of fusion, the remaining gas was dispersed, leaving a bunch of stars, possibly even thousands, in a loose cluster in relatively close proximity to each other. The Sun was once one of these stars. Other more recent models suggest that the original cluster may have actually been denser and more violent than a typical open cluster. This might help to explain some features of how the solar system appears to have formed. But as a member of a cluster, what was interesting about the Sun, however, is that it had a huge protoplanetary disk from which the planets as we know them today, including Earth, would accrete. It stands to reason that many more of the sibling stars in the original cluster would have also had protoplanetary disks that would have formed planets, meaning that there could be hundreds or even over 1,000 cousin star systems wandering the Milky Way with planets in some way related to Earth, having formed from the same cloud of dust and gas. But open star clusters are not permanent arrangements, assuming the open cluster model is the correct one. Once the gas is lost in the star cluster, the stars themselves don't have the collective gravity needed to hold the cluster together, so they themselves wander and disperse. The Sun, having formed 4.6 billion years ago, long ago left the cluster and began its wandering, as did all of its siblings. But for a time, our star was in close proximity to a very large amount of other stars. And we've identified at least one sibling of the Sun and potentially a second, which is an almost identical twin of our star. The more probable candidate is known as HD 162826. This star is of great interest because it shows a very similar chemical composition to the Sun, uncannily so for rare elements like barium and yttrium. When tracking its orbit around the galactic center backwards, it fits the Sun's profile as having originated very close together, though HD 162826 does show a higher metallicity overall than the Sun. And that's interesting, because it raises the likelihood of terrestrial planets in orbit of that star. None have yet been detected, however, but that's not surprising since terrestrial planets are the hardest ones to detect. And while the star isn't too distant, only about 110 light years, it's distant enough to make a search for small planets difficult. But HD 162826 isn't a total match to the Sun. It's somewhat hotter and a type F star, specifically FV8, and very slightly younger than the Sun at 4.5 billion years old. As our planet shows, that's plenty of time for life to arise and spawn a civilization, should there be a suitable habitable world in that star system. But it won't last long. F-type stars, depending on their specific classification, don't live as long as G-type stars like the Sun or cooler stars, but they can in principle last long enough for life. The second candidate is less certain. It's a star known as HD 186302, at a distance of about 184 light years. It's almost a twin of the Sun, being type G3, as opposed to the Sun's classification of G2. It's roughly the same size as the Sun and could in principle have planets, but none are currently known. While similar to the Sun, it's uncertain if it's a true sibling from the cluster due to its orbit around the galaxy being very different from the Sun. But the search for other former members of the Sun's star cluster has only just begun. There are very likely hundreds or even thousands that will be identified as astronomers search the stars, especially in their composition. This could yield interesting results in that they may detect chemically anomalous stars, usually termed peculiar stars, that could even yield a technosignature. There are possible compositions of stars that could only be of artificial origin, and there are several candidates for this already, including Jabulsky's star, with its weird traces of transuranic elements in its composition that shouldn't be there. But within the early Sun and siblings is an open question, leading to a mystery that could potentially change our view of life in the cosmos. There are a number of factors that might end up being filters that prevent the appearance of life in a star system. One of these is the so-called phosphorus problem, where regions of the galaxy seem to be too poor in phosphorus, which is essential for life on Earth, for life to be on the table. But in the case of the Sun and its siblings, of which there are potentially several thousand, they would presumably all be phosphorus-rich, having formed from the same mixed cloud of materials. This alone makes them excellent candidates to search for exoplanets and bio- and technosignatures. But there's another aspect of this early arrangement in the cluster, and it's panspermia. In a cluster situation, the member stars would have been constantly passing by each other in relative close proximity, opening up the possibility that if microbial life had arisen somewhere, say Earth, during the late heavy bombardment as it appears to have done, then that life could have been transferred via panspermia to any number of other stars seeding life throughout the original cluster. It's also possible that there were members of the cluster older than the Sun, which could have spawned life earlier in the cluster's history. This makes for a rather strange scenario where related life ends up naturally spread across the galaxy as the cluster dispersed, creating a common microbial ancestor, then leading to radically different evolutionary outcomes, depending on each different world in its history, including Earth. In short, we could have cousins in the Milky Way that could only be determined to be distantly related through their genetics. And this is a problem. Anytime you share a common genetic origin with something, you are related to it, and thus it can't be classed as alien. This was famously explored in Star Trek from multiple angles. There was the episode The Chase, for example, but also a concept of a planet spawning multiple but related forms of intelligent life, as the Zindi, and the relationship between Romulans and Vulcans. But this actually makes the sci-fi less fun, because it means the species aren't truly alien to each other, but related. This has the rather unsavory implication of never being able to prove an alien civilization actually is one. Say we detect a radio signal of unambiguously technological origin, but it's from a planet orbiting a sibling star to the Sun. The question would then have to be asked about a common origin, and it would cast a pall on the discovery very likely permanently. Thankfully, the galaxy is chocked full of non-siblings of the Sun, so any detection from one of those could reasonably be determined to truly be of alien origin. This is a debate we've yet to have, not having discovered solid evidence of alien life. And it's a debate we may never have if we never discover it, but it's an important point. Distant alien life is hard enough to prove, but the closer that alien life is to you, the less likely it is to be of alien origin, whether it was once close to you in the past or is currently sitting in your star system with you. This goes for everything, no matter how weird it is. So here's a scenario. A civilization shows up in the solar system someday and says hello. We say hello back, and they land on the White House lawn or crash into New Mexico. We get some of their technology and analyze it, and see the isotopes in the metal are different from what we see on Earth, and the DNA of the alien is clearly unrelated to us. Case closed, you might say, but it's not. With high technology comes advanced abilities, and those abilities might be to mess with isotope ratios in their materials, so that can't be trusted. And it might include DNA manipulation or even construction from the ground up. Well, there goes that proof as well. So at that point, you're left with no real way to prove something is of alien origin unless you ask it. Worse, if it's von Neumann probe 3D printing out technology from materials in the solar system, those materials will naturally indicate a solar system origin for the technology. You could ask the alien, but would you trust what it told you of its origins and intent? This is all compounded by an even worse problem, the Silurian hypothesis. It's actually impossible to rule out that a prior technological civilization once arose on Earth, or either went extinct or left it for space and is somewhere relatively nearby now. This is because Earth constantly resurfaces itself, weathers and subducts entire continental shelves, destroying most of the fossil record. We only have an incomplete record, and it's very possible that if we go extinct, our own currently vast civilization on Earth could get geologically unlucky, and nothing survives of our brief period of technological civilization. And here's the kicker. While that scenario is unlikely, it's actually more likely than an actual alien origin for a technology you've found on your planet. This is because interstellar space travel is highly energy expensive, and also takes vast amounts of time. without invoking unicorn technologies like faster-than-light travel, if an alien civilization were to show up at our doorstep, it's very likely they've been traveling for thousands of years and expending vast amounts of energy to get here. So in short, if you detect an alien civilization light years away, there's a good chance it's actually alien and not related, but not necessarily an airtight chance. If that civilization is in your atmosphere with you, it's very likely from your planet no matter how weird it is, and proving that it's actually alien would be far harder than most realize. But back to the issue of the sun's siblings. There is something even stranger hidden in that story, and if by some chance it is the case, then we may end up being the aliens. It's the idea that life on Earth did not originate here, but rather was deposited here, in this case from another star system entirely, early in the history of Earth. This would solve somewhat of a mystery about how life got going on this planet. It literally did it the very first moment it could, suggesting that abiogenesis is straightforward and a rapid process. The problem is it appears to have been a very complicated, unclear process that we can't so far duplicate. So it seems unlikely that Earth would have hit it so quickly, and under the conditions of the end of the late heavy bombardment, this was not a nice, calm planet when life arose. So that leaves open panspermia from either a solar system planet like Mars, in which case we're actually originally Martians, or from another passing star system entirely, in which case we will very likely never know our origins. And strangely, life in its earliest microbial form managed to still conquer interstellar travel by way of a trick of nature and proximity. Amazing possibilities indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently musing that we need to outdo our panspermic neighbors and build a Dyson sphere, a really nice one, with chrome details, and a giant 8-track tape player made of Jupiter playing ABBA on the SETI beacon, and of course a luxurious faux leather interior, though we're gonna need a lot of faux leather for that project, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.